Welcome at our platform Realize Europe. We are now in Rotterdam and we're talking with Yuri van Geef, expert on several domains. I will not mention everything, but anyway, he started with the Singularity University. He was a representative in Europe and he was a very strong expert on exponential development, exponential technology. And he wrote a book on exponential organization, which was one of the most important books mentioned by 50 thinkers. So, which is a very strong and relevant given for our interview. So we're going to do a Socratic interview like we do with all the members on this platform. It will be very short, but it will be a deep dive into the best positive aspects of Europe. So the question is, looking at Europe, from your point of view, all your expertise, what is, according to you, the strongest value, possibility, or dreams we can have thinking about Europe?
Yeah, there are quite a lot. So if you look at the big picture, the strengths right now of Europe relate to, let's say, the Enlightenment, rationality, humanity, tolerance, a strong scientific fundamental research base. So that's great. There's also a particular kind of social cohesion. It's more advanced than, let's say, in the US and also in China, even though it's improving there a lot as a whole. So social cohesion is better. And in terms of dreams, I would say right now we are not in a good place in terms of technological innovation and scale-ups, right? Successful scale-ups in Europe that needs to be improved. It can be improved in many ways. We need to improve the educational system, improve the media system. There has to be more focus on entrepreneurship, on successful entrepreneurs, on scale-ups, to highlight them more into the media. I would say it's also about the political system. So how do we stimulate entrepreneurship as a political system? I think this can be improved in Europe. There needs to be more room for free zones, right? Mm-hmm. So places where we can do small experiments without risks, security, privacy, or medical risks, or so you can contain the risks, right? There needs to be more room for those free zones, like in Japan or South Korea or in China or in sometimes even the US. That's one. So more room for experiments, pilots, driving entrepreneurship. And to adapt the law, the regulatory system, based on the outputs of these experiments. And don't block innovation from beforehand. And I think that's a big thing right now, because regulations are blocking innovation, disruptive innovation, in not all cases, but in most cases, in all systems, vertical markets, in energy, in medical, educational systems. So that's a key thing. So the way to create laws is the same with any innovation, or most innovations, in my view. You have to apply design thinking and lean startup, so Agile and Scrum, all three combined, in a way to do a small test, prototype, pilot, and then see how the law evolves out of the results of the pilot.
It's an iterative process.
Yeah, and with a lot of users, stakeholders involved, but mostly, most importantly, the individual citizens or individual customers, right? And all the different use cases and scenarios. Also, if you look at the media, there was a research recently, the percentage of airtime in media focusing on technology, let's say, not just gadgets, but smartphone apps or whatever, smartphones, but technology as a whole is like 1%. This is pretty remarkable. While we use it like 30% of our time daily, right? Not just your smartphone, but technology in broader terms, like AI and all, human life or private, public life. So that's strange. We need to pay more, give more attention and pay more attention in the media relative to technology as a whole. And the related issues, the ethical issues, the content related issues, the process issues, the whole evolution of technology basically. That's one, media. And then about educational system. If you look at the educational system as a whole, on average in Europe, it's pretty outdated. There is a lack of attention towards applying new technologies, to experiment, to play with it at early ages. That's one. Second, there's a lack of focus on the future-proof meta skills and competencies that are important in any job in the future. Like to, in the educational system, to stimulate and measure and apply curiosity, creativity, collaboration, resilience, being anti-fragile, and to be able to learn and unlearn, most importantly, as a meta skill. And so it's about technology skills, entrepreneurship skills, creativity skills, but also humanity skills. And humanity skills means how to make sense of yourself at an early age. Child yoga, meditation, mindfulness, not for 20-year-olds, but for younger kids. And this is being used in some educational systems in Europe with massive results in terms of more happiness, more alignment, more productivity, more well-being,
yeah,
better social cohesion in the classrooms. So I think that also needs to be applied more.
Okay, so you go a step further in the realization of these proposals. You said we need free zones,
yeah,
in the political system. So that means free of rules, so that we can experiment with
Entrepreneurs, for entrepreneurs.
Like in Japan, South Korea, and some.
But also in governmental services themselves.
Yeah.
To innovate on the edge. In the healthcare system, educational system, the governmental system, even.
Yeah. To experiment with that, and then afterwards adapt the law, and not using the law to block disruptive innovation. Yeah. So that's very essential.
Yeah. So we move away from the precautionary principle.
Exactly.
To pro-cautionary.
Yeah. Yeah, very, very clear. So that means that the free zone will be pilots for new law, rules and regulations and governance. What is the strength of Europe in this perspective?
Yeah, so Europe, if you look at the big picture, Europe is quite advanced in some aspects of quantum computing at Delft, for example. You have the Cambridge-Oxford cluster, tech cluster, which is very advanced. Chip semiconductors, chip development, biotech, nanotech. Switzerland is very advanced in biotech and nanotech as well. South of Germany is advanced in more industrial technology, so 3D, 4D printing, thermoplastics. It's pretty advanced. Photonics is available in Germany and Switzerland. There's a strong technology base now in Toulouse, Airbus.
Yeah,
from Barcelona to up to Toulouse is very strong, emerging. That's hopeful. I would say AI, we are lacking. That's an issue. And also quantum artificial intelligence. There are no hotspots yet in Europe. And if you look at drones and robots, we're pretty okay. Mostly Switzerland, by the way, again. ETH in Zurich. It's pretty advanced.
Yeah.
Also globally. So we have some hotspots. But the thing is, we need to collaborate more. We need to focus on the weak spots. In which we are lacking, like AI, quantum AI, and the emerging fields, photics, biophotonics. So we have a good position, but the main issue, I would say, is to commercialize these technologies, translate them into startups and scale-ups. That's the big shift we should make. If I look, for example, at the amount of tech platforms in Europe, we need to create our own tech platforms, like Airbus for airplanes has been very successful relative to Boeing. It's a European collaboration focusing on a particular domain. We can copy this and apply it to other domains or technologies in this case. So to create a new Airbus-like construction
for several domains.
For quantum computing, for artificial intelligence, for quantum artificial intelligence, because that's different, for photonics, for nanotechnology, for biotechnology. And this way we are able to compete against China and US. We become more self-reliant, self-sufficient. We have more growth, more employment. It's better for our young kids to stay here because it's more fun to do cutting edge work, right? And to apply it and to use it. So that's, I think, a key part of the dream. And the way we should do that is by collaborating more.
European.
Making bolder investments also by the EU, not like 80 billion, the Horizon 2020, is not sufficient. It needs to be 3 to 4x. If we invest more boldly into the future, as a political system, EU, national system, and also as an entrepreneur, and as a VC.
Yeah.
Because the VCs are a little bit more conservative in Europe.
Yeah.
So if we can fix those issues, we're in a good place.
That sounds beautiful. What is your best dream when you wake up about 5 years from now in Europe?
Yeah, so right now we are realizing one of our dreams for Europe, in this case for Holland, but later on for Europe. We see a big issue concerning social cohesion, right? Because of technological unemployment and other developments at play. So one of the components of social cohesion is to reskill and upskill and retrain 1.3 million people in Holland in the next 10 years. Now we are doing right now a pilot, a prototype, an experiment with 10 large corporates, C-suite. Among them KPN, Achmea, ING Bank, Rabobank, others. And also 4 ministries. The secretary generals are involved and approved our and stimulated our project. They are helping us to drive this pilot. Of course, we won't retrain 1.3 million people at first, but we do a few hundred or a few thousand as a pilot. We learn from it, and then we can scale it over time to this large population. And then we will open source it to Europe and to the world.
So that will be a very, very strong value for...
Yeah, so I think Europe can benefit from that, right? So it's also happening in the US in a different way, more entrepreneurial, but we have a more collaboration between public and private. I think that's more powerful. So if we can scale this more rapidly, well, we are in a good place relative to the other continents.
This sounds very coherent with what we discussed till now.
Yes.
So thank you.
Very welcome.
Very good.